reach down and wiped our tears away. Stepped in and saved the day. And once again, I say amen. And it's still raining. But as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain.
Yeah. talked about the mark of the beast, the coming of the Antichrist, some of the plagues that God will send on the earth in the last days. This stuff is coming, ladies and gentlemen. You need to know about it. But we want to skip over a lot of the bad stuff this morning and show you who wins in the end. The book of Revelation, chapter 19, verse 11. The Bible reads as, "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse." Remember, he rode in on Palm Sunday on a donkey. Here he's riding in on a white horse. "And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he do judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." That ought to make you shout. "And the armies which were in heaven followed him," that's you, that's the saints of God, "followed him upon white horses also, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, and with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Say that with me. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's coming back again, but he's not coming back as a humble Jesus. He's not coming back and be hung on a cross again. He's not coming back to be crucified or bleed or beaten for the church. But he's coming back, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the armies of God is coming behind him, clothed in white linen, to finally defeat Satan and his foe. Amen? We win the victory. So don't be afraid of revelations. Don't be afraid of the judgment of God. Don't be afraid of those things that are coming. God said he didn't give us the spirit of fear, but of power and of a sound mind. Amen. We've got to have a sound mind. The devil wants you to lose your mind. How many of you know that? There are a lot of psychiatrists today getting rich, millionaire, writing scripts to people that the devil has them convinced that they are bipolar. The devil has them convinced that they are manic depressive, that they are losing their mind. But God said he will give us a sound mind. Amen?
Thank you, Jesus.
I remember a time in my life where, man, they had me taking all kind of junk. Lithium, Wellbutrin, Xanax, blah, blah, blah. And the list just went on and on and on and on and on. And I felt worse on it than I did before I started taking it. Amen. I had suicidal thoughts. The devil will put some crazy stuff in your mind if you open up your mind to Satan. Amen. So all we need is Jesus. Jesus is the one that keeps me sober-minded every day. Jesus is the one that keeps me from smoking marijuana or doing crack. Jesus is the one that keeps me from cursing people out on the highway and in Walmart writing a check. The days of checks over. Get over it. It's time to swipe your card and go home. Get out of my way. Don't even whip out a $100 bill. They ain't got change anyway. And if they did, they wouldn't know how to count it back to you. And they want $15 an hour. Come on. Trump, give me a thumbs up, Trump. There you go. Amen. But Jesus, and I'm not saying anything. God knows some people need a little something, something, okay? So don't go against your doctor. If you need a little something, some folks are need something. Just I'll put it like that. Amen? Without that something, something, they are showing up. I'll just stop right there before I get myself in trouble. Amen? But in the end, you'll find out that really all you need for peace of mind and be able to sleep at night is Jesus. He'll give you that peace of mind, that peace in your heart that passeth all understanding. He'll give you what you need in your hour of need. God is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Don't fear these things in the book of Revelation. And trust me, there's some awful things coming to pass on this earth. We have preached to you that I believe in my heart that it's too late for America because God's done turned its back on God one too many times. Listen, this was a strong nation at one time. But now we can be defeated by any country that comes up against us. Amen. They have a mentality in this country that everybody wins. Everybody gets a trophy. You have a ball club, and at the end of the season, every team gets a trophy. Man, when I was little, they said, suck it up. You come in fifth place. That ain't nowhere near first. Get you alive. Well, do not get a trophy. No, you get a slap upside the head. You're going to do better next time. Everybody don't deserve a trophy. If you practice, if you work hard, then you have earned that trophy. If you work hard on your job, if you submit yourself to authority, which is your boss, which you need, some people need to do because they don't submit themselves to authority, then you may be the next one in line for a raise. But just because the man in front of you gets a raise don't mean that you deserve one. Amen. Everybody does not get a trophy. Amen? So the mentality of this world now is everything goes. Everything's okay. There's no such thing as absolute truth in these last days. There's no such thing as morals or values. There's no, you are shunned if you go to church. You are shunned if you shout and say, I love Jesus. Let me tell you something. I'll shout up in amongst the biggest crowd. It don't bother me a bit. I know where Jesus has brought me from. I know what He's brought me through. I know the Lord Jesus Christ will deliver me today, tomorrow, and the week after that, and the month after that, and the year after that. It's Jesus the reason why I'm standing this morning. It's Jesus why my heart beats. It's Jesus why I'm going to take my next breath. And I'll not be afraid of Satan and the things that he brings against me. Amen? Speak life. Speak life into your life. Speak life into your family. Speak life into your relationship. Speak life into these things. What you speak, there's power out of your mouth. And that's only God can give you that power. Only the blood of Jesus. If you're not living for Jesus, son, daughters, mother, father, children, it's time to make a decision that in this day you will live for the Lord. As me and my family, we're gonna live for the Lord. We're gonna keep on reading the Bible. We're gonna keep on praying. We're gonna keep on preaching. We're gonna keep on singing. I don't care how unpopular it gets. I've read the back of the book. I know who wins the war. It may be a little old-fashioned to some people, but praise God, Jesus is coming back on a milk-white stallion with the armies of the church behind him, and we'll have victory over Satan and his demons. Amen, amen. Before then, there's a lot of things going to come to pass on the earth, and we're going to go ahead and get to our film, Pastor John, or I'll preach for 45 more minutes, amen, because I feel good this morning. So we're going to watch this short film, and I want you to pay attention. Don't go to sleep, amen? It's going to help you to learn the book of Revelations. Okay, come on, brother. Thank you.
...are the beginning of the major signs that the end days have started. In the series, we will discuss each one so that you will know the sequence of events as foretold in the book of Revelation. The sixth trumpet judgment, Revelation 9:13. Then the sixth angel blew his trumpet. I heard a voice coming from the four corners of the gold altar, standing before God. The voice said to the sixth angel, release the four angels who were bound at the great Euphrates River. The four angels were released for this very hour, of this very day, of this very month and year. They had been kept ready to kill a third of all the human race. I was told the number of the mounted troops, it was 200 million. And in my vision, I saw the horses and their riders. They had breastplates red as fire, blue as sapphire, and yellow as sulfur. The horses' heads were like lions' heads. And from their mouths came out fire, smoke, and sulfur. A third of the human race was killed by those three plagues, the fire, the smoke, and the sulfur coming out of the horses' mouths. For the power of the horses is in their mouths and also in their tails. Their tails are like snakes with heads, and they use them to hurt people. The rest of the human race, all those who had not been killed by these plagues, did not turn away from what they themselves had made. They did not stop worshipping demons, nor the idols of gold, silver, bronze, stone, and wood, which cannot see, hear, or walk. Nor did they repent of their murders, their magic, their sexual immorality, or their stealing. This trumpet judgment declares the start of World War III and the outbreak of worldwide war with nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom. This war will begin during the first half of the seven-year tribulation. The main army at the center of this conflict will be the army of the Antichrist, which will be an Islamic army from the Middle East. The Islamic Antichrist army will wage war in the Middle East and the world, waging war on many nations. The most notable attacks by the Antichrist's army will be against Egypt, and after Egypt, Jerusalem. The declaration of war on Jerusalem will escalate into World War III, which will kill one-third of all mankind. And as the Apostle John described, mankind will be killed by the fire, smoke, and sulfur which comes out of their mouths, which are actually cannons, which do in fact look like fire, smoke, and sulfur. A yellow substance is emanating out of them. And their tails, which he described as snakes with heads, are in fact guns, which like snake bites, puncture people with holes, thereby injuring them, as the Apostle John portrayed. The Apostle John even saw the exact colors of the tank optics, of red, blue, and yellow, which he called breastplates. This global warfare will kill one-third of the world's population. The Antichrist and his Middle East army will conquer and destroy Jerusalem and overrun the city for 42 months or 1,290 days. This will be the worst war mankind has ever experienced. It is known as the Great Tribulation or the Time of Jacob's Trouble. As we discussed in our Fifth Trumpet broadcast in Matthew 24:15, Jesus warns the Christians and Jews living in the West Bank and Jerusalem to flee to the hills when they see this Islamic army approaching, taking nothing with them, for there will barely be time after the announcement to escape. And anyone who does not flee immediately, but turns back to gather his goods, may lose his life. Only those who flee with the clothes on their backs will be saved. During the second half of the seven-year tribulation, God will send Elijah and Moses to preach in Jerusalem, and they will proclaim God's salvation for 1,260 days.
Teroem b'shevet barzel. ככלי יוצר תנפצם, ועתה מלאכים השכילו, הבשרו שופטי ארץ, עבדו את אדוני ביראה, וגילו ברעדה, נשקו בר פן יענף, ותובדו דרך, כי יבער כמעט אפו, אשרי כל חוסדו.
Revelation 11:5. If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes out of their mouths and destroys their enemies. And in this way, whoever tries to harm them will be killed. They have authority to shut out the sky so that there will be no rain during the time they proclaim God's message. They have authority also over the springs of water to turn them into blood. They have authority also to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they wish. The Bible describes that after 1,260 days, when they have finished their testimony, the Antichrist beast and his alliance of Islamic nations will wage war against them, conquer them, and kill them. This killing of the witnesses will happen near the end of the tribulation. These witnesses will have tormented the Middle East with many plagues during the second half of the tribulation, trying to get them to repent and believe in God's only begotten Son. But the Islamic world will have seen them as deceivers, sent by Satan. Therefore, they'll rejoice at their deaths and send each other gifts, and they will leave their bodies on display, refusing to allow them to be buried. And their bodies will lie in the street of Jerusalem for 3.5 days. Then the breath of life from God will enter them and resurrect them, and they will stand on their feet. Those watching them will be panic-stricken, and a voice from heaven will call to them, saying, "Come up here." And they will ascend to heaven in a cloud while their enemies watch them. As they ascend to heaven, a great earthquake will strike Jerusalem, and one-tenth of the city will collapse. killing 7,000 people, and the rest will be terrified and give glory to the God of heaven. Revelation 11:14 says, "The second woe is past. The third woe will soon be here." These judgments declare the final days of God's mercy, after which there will be only judgment for the unrepentant. For God had such love for mankind that he himself came down as the man Jesus Christ to bear the penalty of your sins on the cross. And all he asks is that you accept what he did for you and not reject his sacrifice and suffering which he took for you, so that you might not come under judgment. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
Amen. We will continue that next Sunday morning. Why does all of this have to happen? Why does God have to bring wrath upon the world and destroy so many because of unbelief, because of people turning their back on God, and because of leaders turning their back on Israel, which is God's chosen people? You see, the Lord came and died on a cross over 2,000 years ago with mercy and grace and great love for human mankind. He showed that mercy and that grace and that love on that cross there in Jerusalem as he was beaten and drugged through the streets and carried his own cross. He held that burden of the world in his hand. The sins came on him, every sin of the world, from the beginning of the world to the end of the world. Jesus felt every sin. Every burden that you are carrying, Jesus felt that burden. And as they hung him between the moon and the stars, and he said, "It is finished." Not only was that the plan of salvation, but that was the plan throughout history, from the cross until the end, until God himself comes back and puts a stop to all the troubles and all the sorrows that you're seeing happen on your news, on your TV, every single day. I bet you can't turn even the local news on one morning without hearing of another murder, without hearing of someone else dying a tragic death. Turn it on the world news. 300,000 Christians have been persecuted in the Middle East. The United States has, our president stood up and said, "We are no longer a Christian nation." Let me tell you something. As long as I have breath in my body, I will shout to the hills that I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Saying that we are no longer a Christian nation just says that we are against God. But folks, you have to stand up. You say, "Well, you mean the world will turn against Jesus?" They already have. They already have. God has given us a side to be on. It's come down to 1 billion. 1 billion Islam believers that believe in Allah and that believe in Muhammad. And it's come down to a little more than that, Christians that still stand for Jesus. How many of you know that God won't come to a church where he's not welcome? Jesus won't come in and bless us in a place that he's not welcome. If we say, "You're not welcome in here, Lord, don't come in this church," then he's not going to come in this church. You see, the Holy Ghost is a perfect gentleman. The same way with our country that we're living in. When we say that we are no longer a Christian nation, we have disinvited God to bless our nation as a whole, as a corporate whole. We have said, "We don't need you anymore. We have all the power in the world. We are the greatest nation on the face of the earth." Not anymore, because we do not have God anymore backing us. That's why God has to come back and bring his wrath upon the earth. He's going to cleanse the earth. He's going to cleanse the earth of all unrighteousness, of all the wicked, of all the sin. He's going to come back. And he's going to allow the devil to reap havoc on this earth. But then it says that that new city will descend down from Jerusalem. And God will rule forever and ever and ever. Keep your belief in God in these last days. No matter what the devil tries. I've been talking to so many folks that are having problems in their household. Let me tell you, When you came to this altar and made it right with God, you gave the devil a license to come against you. You did. And it's going to be a battle you're going to have to fight, because you see, now the devil's worried about you. You're a saint of God. You're on the firing line working for Jesus. Before, the devil already had you. He didn't need you. He knew right where you were at all time. You were going to be in the bars. You were going to be in the club. You were going to be in a crack house or wherever you spent your time. The devil already had you. But when you said yes to Jesus, the devil's mad at you. And he's going to try every way he can to come against you, whether it be through your children, through your wife, through your husband, through your job, through your finances, whatever it may be. But hold your family together. Keep bringing them to church. Keep reading the Word and trusting in Jesus. Jesus is coming back for a church without spot and without blemish. We call that the rapture, the catching away. Amen? He's coming back again. It could be before this. I say this almost every week when we preach about Revelations. It could be before this service ever ends, which will be ending in just a moment. You may not never hear another message. You may not never hear another gospel song sang. You may never see the drama team dance for Jesus again in this lifetime. You see, in a few minutes, you could be standing before the Lord. You could be standing before Jesus, and we will answer for every idle word that comes out of our mouth on this. If we've been faithful and true, He's going to say, "Enter in, my true and faithful servant. You've done well." I don't know about you, but I want to hear those words from Jesus. Heaven's going to be my home, and no demon in hell is going to stop me from getting there. You can laugh at me, you can mock me, you can make fun of me, you can do whatever you want to. You can send every demon in hell, devil, but I've got a Bible, and I've got knees, and I'm going to pray in the name of Jesus. You have no power over me or my family. You have no power, devil, over this church. Get out of this place. You're no longer welcome. Jesus reigns in this place because we have invited Him as our honored guest. Amen? Amen. I want you, as Miss Donna and them comes and does my favorite song, "Break Every Chain," I'm going to invite you. I hope everyone in here is saved. If you're not, I'm not going to embarrass you. You don't have to come to this altar. You don't have to make any way. You can receive Jesus right where you're at. You can receive Him into your heart, in your seat right now. I want everybody in here to just bow your head. And whether you're saved or wherever you're at in your life, I want you to pray this prayer. If you're on your way to heaven, I want you to pray this prayer. If you're lost, I want you to pray this prayer. But most of all, believe it in your heart. Believe that Jesus came to this earth. Say these words: "Jesus, I believe that you came to this earth in the flesh. I believe that you died on a cross. And I believe, Lord, that on the third day you were resurrected. Father, forgive me for any sin in my life. Come into my heart. Cleanse me, Lord. Save me. In the name of Jesus, I give you my life. By the blood, by the cross, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen." Now look at your neighbor and say, "I'm on my way to heaven. I'm on my way to heaven." Amen. Come on around, Miss Donna, and dance that song, "Break Every Chain." We're going to give it about 3 minutes. If you'd like to come to this altar and pray, just talk to the Lord. I want my wife to come, and we're going to pray for our family and give thanks. God bless you.
Thank you, Lord. There
is power in the name of Jesus. There is power. Break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power.
Come on.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
offerings, please give the way that you have been blessed. Will now some that morning when this life
answered, Lord. We thank you for the souls that you've saved. Amen. Lord, we just praise and worship your name for everything that you've done for us. Lord, as we leave here, we ask that you just go with us and yes, give us the strength and the boldness to always stand on your word and to testify to your name, Lord. Let us be a light in this world. Lord, we are yours. We belong to you. Use us how you see fit. Let yes, your will be done in our lives and in this world. We praise your name. We ask that you just be with those who are sick, Lord. We ask for healing. Be with those who couldn't make it, Lord. We ask that you do whatever it takes to bring them back in.
Thank you.
Lord, we praise your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
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 Hold somebody's neck before you leave today.
Amen. Oops.